I'm Dr. John Iskander. Welcome to CDC Beyond the Data. I'm here today with Admiral Boris Lushniak, Deputy Surgeon General of the United States. Welcome, Boris.
Great to be here, John.
So people, even people who may know you from your public role, may not know that you're a dermatologist. From that perspective, can you give us some insight into why skin cancer prevention should be such a high public health priority?
Well, certainly. I've been in the public health service now for 27 years, and part of my training is in the field of dermatology. So I kind of bring you this angle of being a clinician at the same time as being a public health official. And from the clinical aspects is realizing that first and foremost, there is an epidemic of skin cancer out there. Each and every year, we have over 5 million cases being diagnosed in this country. Cost of treatment, over $8 billion. And when you talk about the worst types of skin cancer, the melanoma skin cancers, we have over 65,000 people who are diagnosed each and every year and 9,000 deaths. So I've seen that from a clinical aspect of realizing this is a deadly, perhaps a maiming disease as well. And that it is preventable, because so much of the skin cancer that we see in the clinician's office, in the dermatologist's office, comes as a result of ultraviolet radiation exposure.
While you were serving as acting Surgeon General, you released a call to action to prevent skin cancer. Tell us about what is in that and what action steps that translates into.
Well, I think first and foremost, it's really important to realize that the Surgeon General's office has multiple tools, right? We come out with reports, and perhaps the most famous reports are reports on tobacco. We, in fact, when I was acting Surgeon General, issued the 50th anniversary report for tobacco and the issue of smoking in this country and its effect on the public's health. At the same time, although the numbers are somewhat different in terms of the impact on society, certainly as a dermatologist, I felt that we have never really tackled the issue of skin cancer prevention. And a call to action, unlike a Surgeon General's report, is exactly that. Really, you know, precisely looking at those words, it's a call to action. It's for us to put out the science and to say, here's what we know about skin cancer. Here's what we know about skin cancer prevention. And the call to action is really looking at all facets of our society from the individual level. What can I do to really emphasize prevention of that skin cancer? What can local politicians do? What can industry do? Right? What can big government do? It's a call to action at all those levels, including the clinical aspects, including the scientific aspects, including the research and surveillance aspects. So a call to action really is multi-focused. It goes out there and says, here's what needs to get done to prevent skin cancer in this country.
So thinking about some of those groups, individuals, clinicians, policymakers, what should they be doing to prevent skin cancer?
Well, let's begin at the individual level, right? So at the same time that I kind of say beware of ultraviolet exposure, and a lot of the exposure takes place from sunlight, right? I also send out another message, and that's go out and do things with your body. Go out and be active. So it's not a mismatch of concepts here, right? What I'm not saying is stay indoors and just don't do anything. Really, we have the ability for us to turn into a healthy and fit nation, and one way of doing that is, yes, watching what we eat, but at the same time, it's active living. It's going and walking outdoors. It's enjoying the outdoors. And what I'm telling, you know, through our call to action to the individual level is go and enjoy. But there's ways you can protect yourself from that sun exposure. And it's really basic. It goes back to the ideas, prevent tanning and prevent burning of your skin. Although tanning oftentimes is looked at, oh, as a positive cosmetic thing. You know, how many times have you come back from vacation and they say, hey, John, man, you look so relaxed. You're tanned. Look at you, right? Look at you. But the reality is tanning is, by definition, excessive ultraviolet radiation exposure. Now, that's a strange sort of combination of words, but that, in essence, is you've exposed yourself to a known carcinogen. And so at the same time that I say go and enjoy the outdoors, but protect yourself. And from an individual level, it's quite simple. If there's shade, seek shade. If you're going to be spending time outdoors, put on the sunscreen, right? Put on the sunscreen of at least a sun protection factor of 15 or higher. look at it from the perspective of protective clothing. How can I block my skin from this radiation? A wide brim hat, sunglasses, and then enjoy time outdoors. That's at the individual level. If we bring it up a notch, sort of at the policy level, what can we do? Well, to a large extent, it's introducing shade into our outdoor recreational areas. You know, how many times we go to, you know, to see our kids play in outdoor sports and we're sitting in some bleachers, Little League baseball or other soccer games, and yet we're there baking in the hot sun along with the kids. Reality is you can easily put up shade structures, right? That's policymakers' decision to turn our recreational areas into areas that are protected from this ultraviolet radiation exposure. From the clinical aspect, we again work closely with clinicians, be aware of the diagnosis of skin cancer, be aware that when you're looking at your patient, what things do you need to look for in terms of the signs and symptoms of skin cancer, and refer them as necessary or handle them as necessary. From a bigger scientific aspect, as we have to increase our ability to do great surveillance of skin cancers. Right now, the numbers are all estimates. We have a good handle on what melanoma numbers are in this country because those are reportable. But the other skin cancers, the basal cell cancers and the squamous cell cancers, the non-melanoma cancers, are not reportable. And so we really do have to have a more vibrant surveillance system. So those are but three of the aspects that we put out there of saying how we can change our society to be more aware of this known carcinogen, enjoy the outdoors, and protect yourself. The last aspect from a policy perspective is artificial exposure to ultraviolet radiation. And here, yes, I'm talking about tanning booths. You know, in reality, we have a known carcinogen that people are paying money for to expose themselves to. And what I have to be able to do, certainly as the acting Surgeon General and continue to do as the Deputy Surgeon General, is to get the word out that, in essence, these are known carcinogens. And we know who's using these tanning booths for the most part. They're young women between the age of 15 and 26 who are out there and who are inducing this tan, excessive ultraviolet exposure, paying for it, and in fact putting themselves at risk. And there are policies that are being looked at from various aspects of state governments, for example, where we're looking at restricting the use of these tanning facilities, for example, for those under the age of 18. You know, so that we do have warnings out there. The Food and Drug Administration has looked at these devices and has put further restrictions on them. That's another one of these aspects of kind of saying we have a known carcinogen, we have both natural exposure through sunlight we have to be aware of, but certainly artificial exposure through tanning booths need to be taken into account here as well.
So that's very interesting. So with indoor tanning, really that's something that can be worked at the policy level, but people may also have in their communities, their academic institutions, their neighborhoods, the ability to have some influence about, you know, opening of these businesses or, you know, other factors as well, making people aware of the risk that's associated with this type of voluntary tanning.
Absolutely. And I think, I mean, there's two aspects to this. One of which is, yes, there's regulatory public health. There's the ability to actually provide the information. There's also this aspect from us as public health professionals to make sure we get the right information out. Yeah, I think there's in many circumstances, the people who are using tanning booths really don't quite understand the risk they're putting themselves at. And I think we need to be better from our public health communication aspect to get the word out, which is, you know, what you're doing there, you know, by inducing this quote-unquote pretty tan or this lovely tan, this attractive tan, is in fact doing several things, one of which is putting you at higher risk for skin cancers, but also in the short run, it's putting you at higher risk for wrinkling of the skin. Right? You think you're going to look pretty for the next few years. After that, you keep doing this, the skin toughens up. It gets thicker. It gets wrinkled. You appear older than you should be, when at the same time, your goal was to look better.
It's interesting because these sound like actually some of the same arguments and strategies that have proved successful in helping young people smoke less.
Absolutely.
Focusing on these sorts of factors. So can you, to sum up, can you paint us a picture of a future in which we're doing a much better job with skin cancer prevention scientifically and from a policy standpoint?
Well, again, I'm looking at the idea of encouraging people to be outdoors people, right? Of going out and walking with their families, right? Getting into the fitness mode. At the same time, you know, not being paranoid about sunlight, but being aware. You know, did little Johnny, did little Mabel get the sunscreen on? Did I put the sunscreen on this morning, right? Are we being protecting, right? Protecting ourselves, protective of our children, protecting our children against this exposure, right? It's an awareness and it's the implementation of that at the individual and family level, right? That's sort of what we're trying to achieve. At the same time that our communities are built around the idea of, for example, being walkable communities, safe areas to walk, walkability. But in the midst of that, where we have recreational facilities, neighborhood pools, places where people are going to be stationary, introduce the concept of shady structures into the design of those areas. You know, it's so much more pleasant sitting around the pool. You get the exercise and all that, but when on a hot summer day you're in shade as opposed to, as many pools are set up, is nothing but open space. Right? So it's the idea that we have a society that allows for these choices to be made and for ultimately the people to have enough information that they make the right choice. Am I sitting in the sun or am I choosing the shady area? From a further policy perspective, it's looking at a regulatory public health approach and how we deal with tanning beds and the whole industry. There is a lot of similarities, I'll tell you right now, between, you know, what's going on there and what we've dealt with tobacco use in this country. And then finally, from a scientific aspect, is for us to be much more robust, for us to realize what are the preventive strategies that work, how do we communicate them with people so people do understand and ultimately make the right choice.
Thank you very much, Admiral Lushniak, for that call to action and for the practical steps associated with it.
It's my pleasure, John.
Please join us next time for Beyond the Data.